Mina, ohayo gozaimasu, Jesus Freaking Gamer here, and back with the 30-minute message of this week. And like a lot of weeks, this is happening Monday morning and not Sunday because, yeah, my lack of biorhythms and my lack of any discernible regular schedule. There is a schedule there, it's just not readily discernible. So you saw the title, and this title is a very provocative one, and it's not a very nice one. And I've often thought to myself at times, you know, Christians need to make sure that while they are presenting the gospel of Jesus Christ, while they are doing the Christian deed, you know, try to show the love of God, try to present the gospel in a loving way, in a peaceable way, make sure you don't get overly aggressive and overly browbeating with your approach. And make sure that, I don't know, just make sure you're just in general a nicer person. Don't resort to a bunch of ad hominems. The reason I decided to go for the title that I went for is, one, it got your attention, didn't it? Hopefully it got a few people's attention. I know my 30-minute messages aren't the most watched things on my channel. In fact, my messages aren't the most watched things on my channel, and that is fine. But this channel is still here for Jesus Christ. That's the primary reason I do this. I love my games, and I certainly have a different idea of what a Christian can and can't say if you watch those video game videos. Lots of profanity in them, because I just simply hold a different opinion than the majority of Christians and the majority of the church on that issue. But I want to make sure that the message of Jesus Christ is gotten out there, and I want to make sure that as often as I put out videos on this channel, that Jesus Christ is mentioned. This video is going to be a bit more of a scholarly approach. This is going to be, I want to include some practical in here, but there's going to be quite a bit of scholarly stuff, ancient texts looked at, various sources quoted. And the practical side is going to come in first and foremost right here. There is a need in the church to know how to look stuff up. It would be a great asset and a great boon if Christians would simply read the scriptures, read the word. I was like, where's my Bible? Where's my Bible in all this? Right here. Good old Bible. And I use the New King James Version. I like the way it reads. I like the translation. And I'll say a lot of it does have to do with what I'm used to and what I grew up with. Some of it has to do with textual issues, which are certainly beyond the scope of this video. I did make a video discussing why I thought the Bible should be called the Word of God and why that was an accurate title for it. And that was about an hour long. That's somewhere deep in the logs of my channel. If you are interested, by all means look it up. I'm going to try to remember to put a link to that in the description down below. If you thought 30 minutes was long, try twice that long. So just reading the scriptures alone would help many believers. And they don't even do that much. Another thing that they don't do, much less, you know, if they don't even read the scripture, I don't know why they would bother to do this, but to look at source materials aside from the scripture. There is a plethora of evidence for what the Bible says outside of the Bible. If you look into ancient history, ancient archaeology, even some paleontology, various things that the Bible talks about can be found within those fields of study. And paleontology sounds like an oddball example. Just to give you one example, and I'm going to try to give a few homework assignments throughout this lesson here. And a lesson really is the appropriate word for this, and I'll be hitting the main point in just a minute. But for paleontology, did you know that there are sea creatures, fossils found on top of mountains? On top of mountains. How in the world did they get all the way up there? One possibility I would like to postulate is a global flood that covered the entire face of the earth. That is, and that's, I don't know how much that fact is known or even thought about, and I'm sure there is an evolutionary counter-argument to that, I have no doubt. And I know there are some Christians who believe in the Bible and they believe in evolution, so there's no argument there whatsoever. But I just wanted to throw that out there, get some minds thinking, since the title was a bit more provocative, and I'm hoping to get a few comments down below as to where I'm wrong and how things are a bit argued. And maybe some issues in regards to evolution will be brought up because I mentioned that. Maybe some things that I don't talk about in this video at all. And I will try to answer those comments to the best of my ability with the time I have available. All that being said, I wish Christians would do a little bit more study. I wish they would at least read the Word of God. And it'd be nice if they read a few books here and there to find out why they believed what they believed. If they have questions, instead of turning to their best friend, sometimes who's not even a believer themselves, they may be in the middle of who knows what kind of sinful lifestyle, for an intelligent opinion, and the intelligent opinion they get is something quite contrary and contradictory to Scripture. And sometimes they'll just turn to well-meaning friends or sometimes even pastors. And not all pastors are scholars, despite the 4-year, 6-year, sometimes even 8-year degrees that they have, the bachelor's, the master's, the doctorate. Sometimes they simply don't have the answers. Although I want to say more often than not, the Christians don't even read the Word of God, so they don't have any answers to any questions. So when someone says something like, Jesus never existed at all, a lot of Christians would be like, well, that's just foolish thinking and not even give it the time of day. Other Christians would listen to what is said, and or maybe not even listen to like a full conversation, just the thought that someone out there genuinely believes, and there are some who genuinely believe that Jesus did not exist, just that the postulation of that premises would shake them and their faith to the core because they haven't done anything to build up their faith in however long they've been a Christian. Now, if they've only been a Christian for a few days, weeks, or months, I can understand, you know, what the heck? Why is this person saying something really, really different from what I've heard my entire life? Whereas someone who's been going to church since they were a child, someone who's been a Christian for years, but they don't regularly practice their faith, they don't regularly engage in their faith or in any thought-provoking biblical study type way, or they never... I want to say they never look outside of the practical. Sometimes you've got to look into theology. Sometimes you've got to look into the systematic part of it. You've got to look into the more scholarly part of it because sometimes people will pose questions. It'd be nice if you had just some idea of an answer, or if you didn't have an answer, some idea of where to go other than that, you know, completely non-Christian best friend. Or, you know, hopefully, I feel like most Christians wouldn't even go to their pastor. Either they go to a church where they can't go to their pastor, or they simply don't even think about going to their pastor. Guys, if you have a question along biblical lines, don't go to the non-Christian unless you want the antithetical point of view or a completely non-caring point of view. If you want the Christian point of view, go to a believer, preferably someone in authority. And if you don't trust your pastor, one, leave your church and find a church where you can trust the pastor and the people. Two, find someone you can go to with these questions. This might sound a little bit inflated of me, but I do tend to be the go-to guy for some people, for my friends, for the people in my sphere. I do tend to be the go-to guy when someone has a question about the Bible. What does the Bible say about something? Or question in regards to the faith. I tend to be the guy where they're like, you know, well, Brandon, what do you think about such and such? I tend to be that guy. I would like to not be the only one that is that guy. I'm glad I can be that guy. I'm glad that people trust me with very important questions in regards to the faith. Some people, and sometimes they've trusted me with their faith itself. And that is a very distinct honor and privilege that I don't take lightly. At the same time, I want to encourage people to look into this for themselves. And that is the practical side of that message. I probably will visit it once or twice more throughout this video. And I was wondering, do I have enough material to last 30 minutes? I always ask that, and I always have abundantly more because I tend to be a little bit rambly. And that preamble was still incredibly important. That's kind of the practical side of this entire issue. Look into it. Look into it. Yes, have a guy you can go to. Even I have some people that if I have a question, I can go to. I view them more along the lines of they're probably my equals, maybe slightly superior. I don't know. I don't know any feel like ivory tower theologians personally. But I do have people that are at least on my level that know things that I don't and have specialties that I don't. Those kind of people I still have, people that I could entrust the harder questions to. And I do also try to pursue God and pursue research into biblical things on my own. To some extent, guys, at least read the Word of God, know what it says. And I would encourage you just a little bit past that. When someone has these questions, don't run away and retreat. Don't, you know, hide and cower. And certainly don't let your faith be shaken. There are answers. And this, the question that I presented today and the reason I presented such an audacious and somewhat mean title is because I really do, I genuinely think if anyone at this point doesn't believe that Jesus was a historical figure, I'm not talking about the resurrection, all right? I'm not talking about Jesus being God. There are, I acknowledge, intelligent men and women who do not believe that Jesus Christ is God and that Christianity is not the right religion. I even have respect for some of those people. Their arguments are not stupid. Their way of thinking is not dumb. But anyone, I don't care how many pieces of paper they have behind their name, if they don't think Jesus was a historical figure, they seriously need to throw in the hat and find a day job, because they are doing what they're doing very, very wrong. To call yourself a scholar of any means and of any creed, I don't care what you believe. I don't care if you're atheist. I don't care if you're Muslim. I don't care if you're Pastafarian. Yes, that's the thing for those who have not heard. It's quite hilarious. To say that Jesus didn't exist historically is stupid. And I'm going to present several pieces of evidence in that direction. So let's hop right into that. I chose this argument and I chose that audacious title because this is by far one of the easiest things to defend of the Christian faith. I'm a little bit surprised that it is an issue at all. It's not much of an issue because hardly anyone thinks this way anymore, but some do. So, with that in mind, I hope to lay to rest, whether you believe in Jesus or not, and I'll still have an altar call at the end of this message, because I think God will call minds and hearts through what I'm about to say. Even though a lot of it's very strictly mental, not mental as in crazy, but mental as in you're going to have to use your mind to work through this, I still think the Lord can use, excuse me, I still think He can use mental exercises and intellectual data to reach through the mind and into the heart. So, Jesus not being a historical figure. The first thing I would like to say, even if you disagree with the Bible as a book, even if you disagree with it theologically, to outright dismiss it historically is very, very hellacious. That's not even on the liberal or leftist side of scholarship. That is a fringe group. That's practically a little cult at this point. The number of scholars who would completely just destroy the Bible's historical authenticity, that they're very, very few and far between. And that is because the Bible is the most authenticated historical piece of literature in existence. The New Testament specifically. The Old Testament is well attested to, but the New Testament, literally over 10,000 documents, some extant, that means in full, of the entire New Testament are in existence. Yes, there are variables. Yes, there are textual criticisms to be had. But the fact that it exists in the form that it exists, in as many languages as it exists, for as long as it's existed, intact as it is, to dismiss it historically is ridiculous. There are several secular historical pieces that corroborate, back up, maybe slightly alter what the Bible says, but even the alterations are good. Just like, for example, the fact that we have four Gospels and they present four perspectives on the life of Jesus, you would expect different people telling the same event to tell it slightly differently. That's normal. That's natural. That doesn't take away from believability. That adds to believability. And the fact that there are other outside sources outside of the Bible that corroborate what the Bible says, albeit in slightly different language, those are excellent human corroborations of what the Scriptures say. So the Bible is my first and foremost source to say that Jesus was a historical figure. You don't have to believe in the miraculous parts of it. You don't have to believe in the resurrection. You don't have to commit your life to Jesus as God. But you need to acknowledge that that Jesus was a real historical figure. The apostles were actual people. Pontius Pilate really was a Roman procurator at one point in history. The other people that are talked about throughout the book of Acts, such as Paul, such as Barnabas, such as secular figures, such as Felix and Agrippa. The various cities that were worshipped. To give you an example from my past, I didn't know that, this is back in high school, I honestly didn't know that like Zeus and Athena and all the pantheon of Roman gods and goddesses, I thought it was just excellent fiction and excellent literature and tales told to children because they were fanciful and fun. I had no idea they were actual gods with actual temples that were actually worshipped. I did not know that until I read in the book of Acts how Paul and Barnabas were about to be sacrificed to as, oh, who was it? As Jupiter and Hermes, or as Zeus and Mercury. I mixed the Roman and the Greek names. I apologize. That was completely my mistake there. I apologize. But I didn't know they were actually worshipped as gods back in the day. The Bible is actually what pointed me out to that historical fact. And I think I actually ran that by my... You're taught that stuff in English, and I was like, hey, we're told all these stories in English, and it makes for fun literature. And I was a fan of it back in the day. I knew, like, tons of names of gods and monsters and stuff. And I said, did that people actually believe this? And she was like, yeah, this is history. This is real. And I was like, oh my gosh, that's amazing. And that's one example from my life. You can't discount the historicity of the Bible itself. Now, to corroborate that, to give you some other examples outside of the Bible that talk about Jesus, where Jesus himself is mentioned. Let's look at some small cases before we look into the big one. Now, I'm going to say right now that I'm in no way sponsored by anyone or any book or any company that I quote in this video. This is all from me. They're books that I own. They're in my personal library. I use them for study and personal research. So if anyone wants to sponsor me, that'd be great. But I'm not sponsored at this point in time. One of the books that I'm going to be using is The Case for Christ by Lee Strobel. Critics like to tear it up because it doesn't go incredibly in-depth. And I would like to add to that, this was written for laymen. This was written for people who aren't, you know, masters and doctorates in theology, like myself. I would say a lay scholar. And the reason I say a lay scholar, that I'm not trying to exalt myself once again or sound like that kind of guy, but I do read, I'm going to show you a big book here in a minute, I do read some of the ancient texts. No, I don't read it in the original Greek. I read it in English, but I read some of those ancient texts. And a lot of the times I get references from books like this. This is a secondhand source. This points me to original sources. So let's look into some of that here for just a minute. So the first thing that we're going to look at is a Roman historian by the name of Tacitus. Let's read something that he had to say in regards to Jesus. This is a quote, and I'm reading this right out of The Case for Christ, and I'm going to point at something very practical here after I'm finished with this example. This is Tacitus speaking, or I should say writing here. Nero, he was a Roman emperor, fastened the guilt and inflicted the most exquisite tortures on a class hated for their abominations, called Christians by the populace. Christus, from whom the name had its origin, suffered the extreme penalty during the reign of Tiberius at the hands of one of our procurators, Pontius Pilatus, and a most mischievous superstition, thus checked for the moment, again broke out not only in Judea, the first source of the evil, but even in Rome. Accordingly, an arrest was first made of all who pleaded guilty. Then, upon their information, an immense multitude was convicted, not so much of the crime of firing the city, as of hatred against mankind. Now, this passage right here is in reference to the great fire of Rome in the, what was it, in 64 AD, where Nero, like at the beginning, the guilt for that fire was put upon the Christians, who talked about, and there is a passage in 2 Peter that talks about the world burning with an intense heat. So based on that scripture, Nero was like, Christians did it, not me. Wasn't a part of a giant renovation program or anything. Their fault. And so they were captured and killed in great quantities by that madman. If you look into history, Nero was touched in the head, to say the least. And he took it out on my brothers and sisters in times past, which doesn't make me exactly happy. So Christus right there, a reference to Christ, a person who had a name. And now, why should I take, who's talking to Lee Strobel here? A guy called Yamauchi. Why should we take this guy's word for it? You know, who is, and what, you know, why should we believe that Tacitus is being quoted accurately here? Well, in the book, The Case for Christ, there's a little seven. I don't even think I could show it on the camera. And if I held it up to the camera, I'm not even sure if it would show up correctly. But the number seven is there. So I'm going to the beginning of the chapter. This is chapter four. So chapter four, and there's a footnote of seven. So I'm going to the end of the book. And then for chapter 4, next to 7, it says Tacitus, Annals, 15.44. If you look up, and I don't know if this is publicly, I don't know if this is like online or not. I didn't bother to look this up ahead of time. Hey, homework for you guys. And if you can't find it online, you can certainly find it in a library. And if for some reason a library didn't have this particular historical piece, then you would go to, let's say, your college alumnus, or, and I to the best of my knowledge, most universities, their libraries are public. I don't know if you can check books out or not from them. That probably varies from college to college. I didn't go to a regular four-year university, so I don't even know what the principles behind most four-year university libraries are. But you should be able to go there and do some research if you want. And Tacitus, he's not Christian. You don't need to go to a Christian university for this. He was secular. He was not a Christian. He was a Roman citizen and a Roman historian of his time. So you should be able to find that in pretty much any, you should be able to find it in a regular library, much less, you shouldn't have to go so far as to a college library. And very likely, if you go to Google and you type in Tacitus Annals 1544, you might just be able to find it. I won't do that on camera. I'll let you do the research. And if you have to go past the internet, may I encourage you to do just that. Put a little bit of time and effort into your research. And when it comes to things such as religion, I will remind you at this point that we're talking about your eternal soul at stake here. All right? This isn't something of small importance. This is of the utmost importance. If it is something that transcends this life, and things like heaven and hell and eternity are involved, it would behoove you to not be lazy on a point such as this. Go out there and do some homework. If you can't find it online, go out there and do some homework. And when you find someone like Lee Strobel talking about ancient sources, this is a secondhand source. He's quoting the firsthand source. And he leaves, like a good author should, footnotes. The part that most people don't look at, the part that most people just kind of take for granted, if it's important, if it's in debate, look for the first-hand source. Confirm your sources. Make sure that the evidence is what it says to be. Your soul could rise or fall on this argument. And of course, when it comes to just normal research, again, the truth of the matter will rise and fall on the evidence. And the evidence, there are arguments for and against everything historically. Not just, now, Christianity is hotly debated because, well, yeah, it's your eternal soul, heaven and hell. So it's very, very, very hotly contested, but even not so hotly contested points in history, look at various historians, and there are usually, almost always, at least two, if not more, camps on various issues, because history isn't completely clear. Skepticism isn't something that is, it's not something that was necessarily fostered by a bunch of God haters, but rather when you look at if you look at three different accounts and there are differences, an inquiring mind would like to know which of the three is completely accurate, or is there a way to meld all three? And you know, you'll do a few mental gymnastics to make the three work together, but if three don't work together, if one says this event happened at night and one event says this happened during the day, you can't exactly reconcile that difference. So you have to choose which one is right, which one is wrong. And on that point, and when it comes to historical books, again, the Bible is incredibly well put together and incredibly well documented. There may be differences between Matthew, Mark, and Luke. There aren't going to be a ton of differences between all the different Marks that are out there. So, just wanted to throw that out there one more time. But yeah, When it comes to historical things, there are going to be differences of opinion, and sometimes they will be very, very different. So there are going to be multiple camps. Skepticism, I believe, even as a Christian, it's a bit healthy to have. That's why if you look at my hour spiel on the Bible, I actually go so far as to say that the Bible is not the infallible word of God in the sense of there's absolutely nothing wrong with it. No, there are typos in our texts. There are typos in our documents. There are occasionally missing words here and there where you have to look at various manuscripts to find like the complete sentence. So in that sense, we don't have like one pristine copy. And I also think it's a good thing that we don't. I think it is preferable to have the copies that we have, even with the mistakes that are in them. And even though it is 58 minutes, if you're interested, and the Bible and what it says about God is very important, let me encourage you. I will, again, this is a reminder to myself to leave that in the reference down below in this video. Please check that video out. And if it's not me, look into someone who has to talk about this subject. Look into someone. Maybe there are definitely Christians who are the ivory towers. And you can easily find them on YouTube. Find out what they have to say about this topic and about this source. And I'm pretty sure that I linked to some of those ivory tower guys, those multiple doctorate guys, in my video that's on the Bible. So if you want to hear it from a mouth much more educated than mine, you can. This is more like lay scholar stuff. And I use that term with weight. I don't take the fact my own research lightly, but I also say lay scholar loosely because, you know, I study this stuff in English. I don't have the degree behind my name. I'm well aware of my shortcomings and weaknesses. At the same time, I do look into this more than quite a few people. Unfortunately, more than quite a few Christians as well. So, with those things having been said, let's look to another person who had another secular source in regards to Christianity. And this would be Pliny the Elder. He is an, again, just not a Christian. He was a friend of the Emperor Trajan, and he wrote stuff. So let's look at what he had to say. And wow, I did not honestly think that this was going to be a two-parter, but it's going to be because I ramble on and on and on. So this is Pliny the Younger. I have asked them if they are Christians, and if they admit it, I repeat the question a second and third time, with a warning of the punishment awaiting them. If they persist, I order them to be led away for execution. For whatever the nature of their admission, I am convinced that their stubbornness and unshakable obstinacy ought not to go unpunished. They also declared that the sum total of their guilt or error amounted to no more than this. They had met regularly before dawn on a fixed day to chant verses alternately amongst themselves in honor of Christ as if to a god, and also to bind themselves by oath, not for any criminal purpose, but to abstain from theft, robbery, and adultery. This made me decide it was all the more necessary to extract the truth by torture from two slave women, whom they called deaconesses. I found nothing but a degenerate sort of cult carried to extravagant lengths. And this is again quoted directly from The Case for Christ, quoted directly from this book. Again, this is going to be chapter 4, and the footnote there is 8. So again, I'm actually purposefully turning to the page here on camera because I want you guys to look at the process that I go through to do my research and the process that you can go through. So again, by chapter 4, footnote 8, Pliny the Younger, letters 10.96. Again, look it up on Google. Do some homework if you want to read this, to read on Pliny's letter or this part of this letter in its extant or full form. And if you can't find it on Google, go to a library, whether it be a public one or a university one. This information is out there and can be found. And I want to add at the end of that note that I'm very glad that I live in America where knowledge is as extant as it is. I'm glad we can freely and easily look up all of these various things. So those are some corroborating things that go with the Bible, which is the primary of primary sources. You want to believe in the historicity of Jesus? Those are two Romans right there who speak of someone called Christ, and this Christ who is worshipped as a god would be worshipped. So that name was known, And if you look at, and it, since it's the Christian movement, we know they're referring to a specific, the specific man there and the specific person they're referring to there would be Jesus. No mental gymnastics are needed to figure that out. So that's part one of two. Let's end this on the note. Some of you don't need further convincing. Some of you right now, God's reaching into your heart. You know Jesus was not only a historical figure. You've been, I don't think I said anything necessarily convincing of the resurrection today, but some of you guys know that you need Jesus. Some of you guys have heard about this for quite a while. Now's the time to surrender your life to Him. Now's the time to not put it off any longer and just give your life to Christ. Admit that you've sinned. Admit that you believe that He died on the cross for your sins and that He rose again 3 days later. And if you want a model prayer to go after and to pray, pray this prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I admit that I'm a sinner. I admit that I need your help. I believe you died on the cross, shedding your blood for my sins, and I believe you rose again on the third day, promising me eternal life. Thank you, Lord, for your promise. Please be my God, my Master, and my Savior right now. Amen. If you prayed that prayer and meant it, congratulations, you are now a part of the family of God, and it is wonderful to have you. If I could encourage you to read this book, if you're wondering about, well, can I really trust it based on what you said earlier, check out my message down below. Check out the references in that particular YouTube video. I think it'll be very, very helpful for you. It is the Word of God, and it can be trusted, and I read it and preach on it daily on this channel. Also, find a group of people, usually you're going to find at a church, of believers who believe the same thing as you do. It is incredibly encouraging and helpful to find other people that, like some of my friends come to me, and I tend to be kind of the Bible dude in my circle. Find a circle of people who you can not only talk to the Bible about, but just talk about, you know, normal life stuff. Some people that you can befriend and hang out with. It's incredibly helpful and encouraging to the faith when you find other people of the same faith. And also, shoot up a prayer to God every now and then. Just a little thing like, God, thank you for the day, or God, this day sucks, please help. God hears that prayer, it counts, and He will answer it. If you're only wondering what the big book behind me there is, look forward to part two. Guys, it's so funny that so many of my messages end up being part two. I prepare so much to make sure that it's 30 minutes long, and then it ends up being two 30-minute messages. Like, what? Well, hey, it gives me another message to preach, so I'm good with that. Thank y'all so much for watching this video and for taking the time of day to just watch me and listen to what I have to say. Thank you so much for that. I love you. God bless. Ooh.